As we've seen in the Midwest this spring, it's scary when rivers crest above their banks or burst their levees. Rising water can be dangerous and cause property damage. But springtime flooding is also a natural part of a river's cycle. On the Rio Grande, spring floods help nurture the cottonwood bosque, allow fish to spawn, and benefit all sorts of other species too, including humans. This year, the Rio Grande is expected to keep running higher than it has in recent years, all the way through June. In this month's Our Land, correspondent Laura Paskus takes us to the Rio Grande in Albuquerque and to a habitat restoration site near Socorro.
Before the Rio Grande was tamed with dams and diversions, it moved back and forth across its floodplain, scouring the valley and slinging its silty waters. At some places in Albuquerque, it was 5 miles wide. Then, early last century, we started squeezing the Rio Grande into a more and more narrow channel. We wanted more infrastructure for farming, and we started building thousands of homes in the floodplain. In many ways, we stopped letting the Rio Grande act like the grand river it was.
Decades ago, Reclamation had channelized the river. At the time, we thought that was the best approach. But now as time progresses, like, you know, in all history, we've learned a better approach, you know, trying to work within the river processes.
Ann Demint is an engineer with the U.S. Bureau of Reclamation. In recent decades, water managers have had to comply with the Federal Endangered Species Act and make sure their operations don't cause rare species, like the southwestern willow flycatcher and the Rio Grande silvery minnow, to become extinct. Agencies like Reclamation have spent millions of dollars up and down the valley trying to turn back the clock and mimic the natural river system.
The river used to have side channels like this quite a bit, and what the side channel offers is habitat for the silvery minnow. And so the minnow will come in here and they're able to find the slower water, and it also helps them propagate. So they'll spawn in these areas, and then the minnow larvae will grow and become adults here, and it provides an area for the minnow. But it also benefits the riparian vegetation.
In other places, there are projects to remove non-native trees like tamarisk and plant native trees. In some places, agencies lowered the banks of the river to help connect it with its historic floodplain. Biologists are out checking the side channels and restoration projects to see where silvery minnows are and how their populations are doing.
Well, we got a couple of them.
You did get some?
Yep.
Last year, as the river dried south of Albuquerque, most of these restoration sites didn't get any of the much needed water. But this year is a different story.
Years like this, where we have really good snowmelt, like this year I think we're running somewhere like 150% of average snowmelt, are really important for the river. You know, it's kind of like a resetting time. It benefits the vegetation, benefits the groundwater, the aquatic species, the silvery minnow, but then also the birds, you know, like the flycatcher and the yellow-billed cuckoo, you know, depend on flows like this. So it's really important just for the overall ecosystem health.
Chris Torres with the Bureau of Reclamation was the construction supervisor on a habitat restoration project on the Rio Grande near Escondida. This project helps minnows get out of the high flows of the river channel and find slower waters where eggs and young fish aren't swept away.
I'd love to build a project and see it function perfectly, you know, and to have that something tangible that you can go home and say, you know, my crew built that, and I can come home and bring my family out here and see that this is their public land, and we built this, and it's working correctly, and then see it in years to come that it's still working the way it's supposed to.
Work like this comes directly out of compliance with the Endangered Species Act, but engineers, biologists, everyone is learning more about what works and what doesn't when it comes to trying to restore habitat and a more natural river system.
The engineers will design a certain cut and everything's very angular and nice 90 and 3-to-1 angles, but we try to incorporate that and make it more natural. You know, lay some of these banks back, save some of the plants where we can, relocate the plants that have to come out up onto the bank, and just really take some pride in it, you know, and turn it kind of into an art. So when you could turn around and say, you know, this plant was dedicated or was going to come out, we plucked that sucker out and we put it in the ground over here and it took, you know, so it's going to be there for future generations.
As the climate continues to warm, there will still be wet years and dry years. And along the way, hopefully we'll learn how to work better with the water we have while remembering to let the Rio Grande still be a river. For Our Land and New Mexico in Focus, I'm Laura Paskus.